The Big Apple has been shut down to its core.
The East Coast is being pummeled with the power of a record break.
We realized the devastation that had struck while we were watching the TV from Florida. I mean, we were calling home, we were calling friends and family.
1,000 miles long, delivering the kind of brain scene one
every New York City's mass transit services are suspended.
You never think a hurricane in New York, usually think a hurricane in Florida. And so it was really that, the juxtaposition of being in Florida and seeing a hurricane rip through New York and really create devastation. We really need to do something.
I think it's safe to say now that we are beginning to see the worst of the storm. Sandy did make landfall a little bit earlier than expected.
And we have a fire that is inevitably going to get closer because of all of the wind.
100 homes were burned.
Manhattan already breaching the promenade there.
And New Jersey Governor Chris Christie calling the devastation along the Jersey Shore, quote, unthinkable.
With house to house checking for signs of life.
Howard and I came back on the 31st from Miami, and over the next couple of days, we decided we were going to help. That Saturday night, which I think was November 3rd or 4th, we went out for dinner with two couples, and I mentioned the fact that we wanted to help, and both couples said, count us in. We want to do whatever we can to help, too. It really tugged at our heartstrings, and you know, we wanted to do something about it.
On September 11th, every year, we don't take a holiday. We all go to work. And 100% of the revenues of the firm all go to charities that are important to employees, clients, and the celebrity ambassadors who come on in and represent them on the floors, making it a fun day and a memorable day. When Sandy hit, we had had our charity day in September, and so we still had the funds. And Howard and I had been engaged in conversations about what we would like to do going forward.
The only way we found that we could give money to really the people affected by Hurricane Sandy was to do it ourselves, to really dig into the neighborhoods, to go out and to create an enormous, enormous group of people who are going to go out in the field, touch the people, and give them the money.
Howard called and said, Haid, you know everything that we were talking about when you were saying what you wanted to do with the relief fund going forward? I said, yes. He said, this is it. He said, we can do Sandy, and we can do it big.
So I emailed 20 of my friends the night of November 6th, explaining to them that I wanted to have a kickoff meeting on November 7th, and would they like to participate? And 17 of those women showed up the next day. And after the first week or two, I'd say my crowd grew to about 28 women and two men, my brother and Marcy Lehrman's brother, Matt.
We have 5,500 families that we're pretty far along with, that we know what to do. Now it's really going to be how to do it, right? Which was the last, right? We said what we're going to do, where we're going to do it, right? Who we're going to give it to, and then how we're going to give it to them.
Well, I remember the first, the first meeting. Allison comes to my office and says, "Come on, we got to go upstairs." And I'm like, "What do you mean?" She's like, "Well, all my friends are upstairs, and they're not going to wait." I was like, "Listen, this is my office. You know, I come up when I come up. I'm on the phone." She's like, "Let's go, let's go, let's go."
Well, I had to schedule things in a certain way. You know, these are all women that work out every day and women that lunch. So my scheduling revolved around their schedules.
I kept trying to push her to do a conference call. And her view was that these women would just never be as invested if they weren't here together and if they weren't making the decisions together in person, connecting with each other.
We knew we were going to donate millions. The question was how many millions and how many people can we help?
When you want to take care of people and you want to help them, these people don't want to take money. They're not in the business of taking. And they're proud people. So you have to give them money with respect.
We really were trying to figure out what to do, and we realized that the safest thing to do would be to give out some sort of gift card with their name on it.
My husband and I have been in the marketing businesses for many years, and I kind of remember that he had a similar problem. And he said that he had this terrific guy who has a company called Payoneer. He could actually set up a system for Cantor to distribute the money by putting like the money in a big bank account and then having credit cards.
Howard explained to him what we were trying to do, and he agreed to donate, you know, 10,000 prepaid Payoneer credit cards.
We knew from our 9/11 experience that while having young children is a fabulous joy, it is also an added responsibility in the times of trauma. And so we decided we were going to adopt families who had children enrolled in elementary schools in hard-hit areas of Sandy.
How do we find these people? I mean, how do we decide who to give to? It was a huge question, and we spent the whole first meeting really focused on that, because once we figured out how to distribute the money, you know, who we were going to distribute the money to, then we could figure out how to do it.
So we put this big map on the wall, and we figured if we would maybe pick 8 to 10 towns, and we thought, how do you narrow it down?
It had just been election day, and Howard and I went to vote, and we saw all those lists, you know, of all the district, people that live in the district, and we thought, hey, that might be a really good way to narrow it down. Howard and I brought this up, and we asked for everyone, you know, tell us what you think, do you have any other ideas?
So we need lists, right? We need qualifying lists, right? You need the students in the qualifying list. You need to find a way to say, okay, how are we going to do this?
And Amanda Orso said, I think we should do it by schools.
What we ultimately ended up doing was adopting 19 schools in Brooklyn, Queens, Staten Island, Long Island, and New Jersey.
We always knew that there was going to always be some sort of obstacle. Nothing's easy. There's always red tape when you want to give money.
Now the principals, they knew what we were trying to do, and because we were Cantor Fitzgerald, they gave us the benefit of the doubt. The New York City schools had a problem. Not the principals wanted to do it, but that the superintendent said, hey, this is against policy.
The bottom line is, we want to give your families $1,000 cash. You can't stop us, and if you do, it's going to look really bad for you.
Now, fortunately, when we first came out with this program, I called the mayor, and so he knew about it from the beginning. And so when they went to ask the chancellor, and the chancellor spoke to me, and I explained what we were doing, and he said, all right, I'm going to have to go run it up to City Hall.
The chancellor came in, and he said, what can I do to help? And Howard answered, nothing. You just got to stand down. We will take care of the rest.
And he did just so. And so the principals did what they wanted to do, and they enabled us to get the lists, to print up the cards, to bring the cards to give them out.
Everyone left every meeting with a homework assignment, and they had to be prepared for the next meeting. So, you know, after the first meeting, everyone had to go home and everyone had to call their schools. And everybody had to speak to the school superintendent, speak to the school principals. Everyone had to go out to their sites. When I went out to the Rockaways for the first time and I came back into the meeting, I realized, and I spoke to Howard about it, I said, there's no way you can possibly understand unless you go out there and see it for yourself. I mean, it's all well and good to say I'm going to help, but you need to see it. And so once all of the teams were organized, every team was committed to going out to their sites and driving around and actually seeing firsthand what had occurred.
Rockaways was the first site visit. There was so much devastation. It was baffling to me, block after block. There was a boardwalk, which was cracked in half.
Staten Island was a war zone. The waves, we understood, were 80 feet high coming off the ocean and went a mile in and just wrecked everything. It was devastation.
It was really like something out of Planet of the Apes. It was totally devastated, and we were very devastated.
You saw their homes, and you saw all their properties, and you saw their comforters and their pillows, and it really was like being at Planet of the Apes.
Our family rented in Breezy Point during the summers, and that really hit home for me, seeing Breezy Point completely devastated.
I had seen the communities that I grew up in and where I visited on the weekends, and I was blown away. I saw the Jersey Shore where I went with all my friends, and there was nothing left.
There was this one house in Union Beach, New Jersey. Half the house was knocked away, and all you saw was clothes hanging in a closet.
In Keensburg, we met the mayor, and he brought us into his own home, which was destroyed.
You saw, you know, his wife's clothing everywhere, photos. I mean, the kitchen completely floors up.
We went to Brooklyn, I think, was the first area that we went to. And we pulled up to meet one of the local officials. And we pulled up into this giant parking lot. And there were tents with people, you know, obviously donating food and water and all that. And there were lines, you know, miles and miles down the road.
We went into schools that were closed down, that were, you know, devastated. We walked through homes that were, I mean, you just cried.
The site inspections were really tough because you don't realize how TV shuts you off from what you're about to see.
It was quiet. You know, there were National Guard and police and just people milling around helping, carrying couches and furniture out of houses. Just everything was out on the street.
There was like a 2x4, maybe it was bigger than a 2x4 actually, a piece of wood as a marker, stuck into the ground, and it had a picture of two young kids. And it was the spot where the kids had been wiped away by the hurricane.
This car over here that you can see in the distance, this is the car that she was driving.
The bodies of both children were found not far from each other.
Two boys, two and four, dragged from their mother's arms by...
I remember walking, we were into this area in Long Beach, and there wasn't a house. I mean, all it was were beams. And every possession that these people had, they were piled maybe 25 feet high.
And Howard stood outside of a house, and he was crying.
We really wanted to set up the distribution in a way that was, that had a lot of integrity.
It's close, but it's not right. You say, stay on the line. Here's a green card. They're going to raise their hand. I'm going to walk over to them and I'm going to say, okay, how's your name spelled? They're going to show me their ID, and then we're going to decide right then if it's only missing one S, the credit card's probably fine. But if they need two, I'm going to go to the solutions and write a check. Right? And then they're going to go right in. Someone's going to pull their card, go here, destroy the card, and write them a check.
We also knew that what you have to do is create a sense of community, because community is the other thing that really helps people heal.
We're giving $10 million, $5 million from this year and $5 million to next year to 10,000 families, $1,000 each.
They're walking in and they're feeling, they're at the lowest point in their life to begin with. So to get them excited about what's going on and make them feel good about what was happening, and also not to make them feel like a charity case. To make them feel like, you know what, you're just like everybody else and you were in the wrong place at the wrong time.
A lot of times they were speechless. They didn't even know what to say. They said, thank you, you know, thank you, I can't thank you enough. I don't know what to tell you. You know, you changed our lives. And seeing their smiles, seeing tears of joy even, you know, it's really heartwarming. And it shows we did a good deed.
I'm so touched.
What I feel like is that people felt that the opportunity to go out there and touch the people and hand them the gift card directly.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Good luck to you. As opposed to sitting back, writing a check, or, you know, doing something here in the city would be the most meaningful. And it was a powerful experience.
One woman came up and I said, by signing this, you're acknowledging that you were adversely affected by the hurricane and you will be receiving $1,000 in relief from Cantor Fitzgerald Relief Fund. And the woman looked at me, I looked at her, and I could just see it in her eyes. And she had the pen in her hand and she said, I can't sign it. I wasn't affected. I just can't sign this. I'm gonna give the money back to the school.
I worked at the solutions table with Allison. You think she's like this very quiet, gracious girl who, you know, doesn't, you know, so easygoing. Girl's like a tour de force at the solutions table. People would come over with all these stories. I've sole custody of my kids, so I really need the card to be in my name and not my wife's. And Allison would look at them and she'd say, you know I'm gonna investigate this, right? You know that if you don't have sole custody, like, I'm gonna find you out. Like, she was like, and the guys were like, okay, you could do 50-50. I mean, Allison has
everything had to be a proven case before we would give them a check. So we went as far as calling the principals if we were at another school, or getting on the phone with the parent and like verifying the information. Some schools you'd have a grandfather and a daughter who both had children the same age in the school. So we only had one card name. And we, as we're trying to figure this out, we're literally drawing family trees to figure out, okay, yes, it is actually two different children and they do get two donations.
One of our schools in Coney Island had seven languages in their school that were spoken commonly.
It seemed like we were never going to get through the line. It was, and not only were the people, were we freezing, but these people were also out there freezing cold. It was hard to, you know, maneuver all the papers and the IDs, and sometimes you can't read the names.
You know, you want to give everybody their check, and you want everybody to, you know, you want to tell the person that you're going to get your money, and they all worked it out.
Through queue, you got to just wait a minute. Otherwise, you can go in.
Six is a separate table.
Sorry, M-N-O-P-Q, just wait a second. Everyone else can go in.
You have a popular last name.
Sorry, just too many people are married.
To me, it was just all these little moments of who these families were and the great sacrifices they were making. Or, you know, the nurse who's running because she has 15 minutes on her break from the hospital, and if she can't get her check quickly, you know, just how appreciative they were that this could all be done so seamlessly.
Go ahead, guys. And I can take three or four CRDs.
It was very special to be part of, you know, helping people in some way. When you do your count in the beginning, was an overwhelming feeling because you knew you were personally giving, you know, that money and helping get that money out.
We had one woman who came once and she was extremely thankful, and it was in Long Beach where most of the people were so amazing. And she came over to us and said, thank you so much. I brought you guys a gift. And she said, I had to give something up for Lent, so I brought this for you. And we opened it up and it was a bottle of Patron.
Howard was so kind. He walked around, he was shaking hands. He was, you know, mixing in with all of the people that were either waiting in line outside, waiting in line inside.
Which is my newsletter. Hello, nice to see you.
Thank you so much. It's really, really appreciated. And they created an environment that just wasn't intimidating.
To see the three Letniks together, working hard, and just you could see how happy it makes them, making other people happy just by the joy and smiles on their face. You could just tell.
It's helpful, you know, for families in need.
If it wasn't for this money, we would be going in the show. You know, I really thank you so much.
You're so welcome. It's our honor. It really is.
Edie has a very special way with people. She's, you know, she really can just reach out to people. She knows how to talk to them, very much like Howard. You know, she's just a really good people person. So Edie's main job was really at the solutions table, where, yes, she signed the checks, but she dealt with all of the issues.
We went to Long Beach. There were five schools in one day. In 2 hours, we gave away $1.35 million. When in your life do you ever get to do something like that?
One of my, you know, fond moments was we went to one of the first schools. The kids performed for us. We went into their auditorium, and they just sang this beautiful song.
The title of the song is Give Us Hope. And we know this song was especially dear to us because people have given us hope, and we want to thank you for what you've done.
You know, you have this whole auditorium, these spectacular children up there who sing the most beautiful song to us, and they just, it's made you cry.
There's one woman, and she just looked at us, and she like started choking up. I'm gonna choke up too, and her eyes opened, and she said, you have no idea how much this means to me. I was devastated, and you people are angels. And I was like, oh my God, wow.
I believe that we're all put on this earth to do something, and I just feel that Howard and Allison, this is what they're meant to do, and I think we're just helpers. Can you feel the beat of my heart?
the opportunity to be able to give and give and be a part of that giving is just such a warm feeling and really, I don't know, just definitely a beneficial one.
It's not often that you get the opportunity to really give back like that. You know, this really provided for myself an opportunity to volunteer. Those opportunities don't always come up where you could actually really make a difference.
There's nothing better than giving, right? That is better than even receiving. Being in a position to be able to give to the people you even know, but don't know, I don't know if there's even a difference, really, because people appreciate what others can do for them.
Everything about it was worth it to me. I mean, not only was it a total learning process, you know, really trying to figure out everything from soup to nuts and really accomplishing your goal perfectly. It was a people experience. It was not only dealing with the people that had suffered, but working alongside friends and some family members who participated, and you know, having that whole experience was, you know, unforgettable.
I can't be more proud of my wife and all of her friends. She was amazing.
I couldn't have done it without my friends participating. And now that it's over, you know, they want to know what my next project is.
We felt we had to help these families. And what we learned on 9/11 was not to be paternal, but really the best way to help these families is to put money in the parents' hand.
Today is Friday, June 7th, and we arrived in Oklahoma City.
Yeah. These were all homes.
Yes. And we know it's an F5 because of the tree.
We've committed $2 million. We're going to get all those volunteers. My wife and my sister have collected all of their friends and all these volunteers. We're going to fly out to Oklahoma, and we're going to pick some schools with kids, 2,000 families, give them $1,000.
Fantastic. I really do applaud you for it, and it's always good to see you back on the show.
Great to see you, Pierce.